Penguin Random House Audio presents The Black Yearbook, Portraits and Stories by Adraint Khadafhi Bereal. Foreword written and read by Kiese, Laymon. This is the author, Adraint Khadafhi Bereal, with additional narration by Jonice Abbott-Pratt, Torian Brackett, Ron Butler, Benjamin Charles, Marcella Cox, Kaylor Lee, Angel Peen, Reynaldo Piniella, Malik Rashad, Andre Santana, Zoleka Vundla, and Henriette Zutimo. Note to listeners, this program includes a downloadable PDF which contains select photographs taken by the author from the book. For those who dare look up, thank you, Aya, for teaching me kindness.
Foreword by Kiese Laymon. We often call books that blur categories genre bending, but what do we call work that bends our actual memory of what happened and our imagination of what is happening? This is what Adraint Bereal has made here in supposed elite college space. A space many of us believe to be beyond our imagination, and after surviving it, a place our memory often smudges because it longs to survive free of the wrong kind of weight. I've read the book 4 times and felt gutted 44 times by what Bereal has managed to do with our experiences and imaginations as students on these campuses. In the wildest and really sort of shameful turn, Bereal forced me to sit with what it means to be conceived and raised on a historically black university in Mississippi, then move on to attend a Southern white liberal arts college, then a Midwest progressive liberal arts college, then a Big Ten university, then a tiny so-called prestigious college on the East Coast, before ultimately moving back to teach in Houston, Texas. These institutions are home to me, and home is sick. More than anything, the Black Yearbook will show us the importance of photography and our desire to piece together meaning in this intentionally harsh, anti-Black place. I've never felt more honored and awed by an exploration of what we make of ourselves in spite of these institutions and their deficiencies. Colors, shapes, and textures matter. We are colors, shapes, and textures. We deserve art that honors our artful existences. Those of us who survive these places will find a new, blue kind of love in this here place. We are so lucky Bereal loves us. This is The Black Yearbook.
Introduction. We are proud of what you have accomplished this far in the journey of life, but we hope you don't think that you can settle for what you have done as the ultimate accomplishment. Not only are we proud of what you have done so far, we expect you to reach higher and achieve greater success. Now, with you being the leader, we want you to understand that the road of life gets hard, and not everyone wants to see you succeed and do well. Keep in mind that you are not alone, and not only do we want you to do better and go farther, we demand it. If you get tired, take a break. If you get hungry, nourish the body. And as you journey, in all thy getting, get understanding. This is what Aya, my grandpa, said to me when I graduated from college. As a first-generation college graduate raised between Waco, Texas and Hattiesburg, Mississippi, I had no expectations of what college was supposed to be. At the University of Texas at Austin, UT Austin, I enrolled in an advanced photography course, even though I had never studied photography under a professor before. The class was thesis-based, so each student was tasked with choosing a topic and working from there. I initially wanted to explore the relationship between Black men and femininity, but I realized there were too many nuances to communicate in one semester. Then, as I looked deeper into the campus demographics, I discovered that in the fall semester of 2017, only 925 Black men were enrolled at UT Austin. My fellow Black peers and I already knew the number was low, but it was jarring to see the true number. You could fit all of UT Austin's Black men in the school's events auditorium and still have seats left over. In my time on campus, the Black student population would remain at less than 5%. making up a small cluster on a campus of about 50,000 students. I decided to spend the following 2 years taking photographs and interviewing these Black students about their experiences. The resulting work became the catalyst for what you will read and see here. Since the founding of the oldest university in the country, Harvard University, in 1636, college has always been considered an exclusive space for the rich and powerful. Over 385 years later, this threshold of entry has expanded, but things have remained the same just as much as they have changed. I traveled to schools from coast to coast for 4 months, connecting with these students and learning about their most personal moments in college. Being Black is the only thing I had in common with them. We were strangers, and yet we were able to create this safe space of curiosity, learning, and growth for each other. Accompanying these conversations and narratives are analog film portraits of the students and their environments. These images are meant to take away the brochure depiction of Black students and give back truth to our existence. Such is the power of the photograph, of the image, that it can give back and take away, that it can bind, said the late bell hooks in her essay, In Our Glory, about her relationship to an image of her father. This book binds us in time, but we will continue to grow and evolve beyond these pages. So, whoever you are as you begin your journey, in all thy getting, get understanding. Predominantly White Institutions, PWI. While visiting some public and private predominantly white institutions, I learned that many students share similar sentiments about fitting in, feeling accepted, dealing with the available academic offerings, navigating social hierarchies, and more. As for racism on these campuses, every student's experience with it is unique. For some, racism is blatant and presents itself as hearing the N-word shouted while casually walking to class. For others, it is more covert and masquerades as microaggressions that aggravate just enough to get under their skin, but never enough to warrant repercussions. These are the examples that come up when we talk about the experiences of Black students. To set aside my own biases and personal experiences, I decided to lead many of these interviews with a simple introduction, yet I consistently found myself on the topic of racism. In a lot of ways, I was trying to avoid talking about it, but then you would not be talking about the Black experience. It's deeply ingrained in the way Black people move through the world and how others perceive us. It was important for me to not unwrite the pain endured by these students. I didn't want these stories to be passed off as either small moments of adversity or joy. Both exist, but one word alone is not all-encompassing of a life. After all, maybe the refusal to reconcile with racism is why there is so much pain in proximity to collegiate narratives. If these students can bravely confront their reality, the people around them should be able to do so as well. The racial conflicts that the students face at predominantly white institutions lack resolve. Very rarely did these students see anything dramatically change in the duration of experiencing these hardships. And some legacy students found themselves still fighting the same battles their parents did when they were on campus. When we look back at historical roadblocks, the racist uproar in response to cases such as Sweat versus Painter and Brown versus Board of Education is treated like an obsolete issue of the past. The pictures may be in black and white, but the lived experience is in color. The voices of hatred belong to real people. There are Black people alive today who still have the images of pitchforks and various objects being hurled their way while simply trying to pursue an education. Ruby Bridges is still alive today. A wound cannot heal if it is not treated as such, and as I've seen it, we will continue to revisit this narrative until Black students feel safe and free from racism. Another main concern that kept coming up in conversation was the 5-mile radius surrounding these schools, often a facade of curated businesses that only cater to the type of student body, alumni, and tourists that the institution supports and prefers to be associated with. For example, when in New Haven visiting Yale, you can stop for a slice of Barr's famous mashed potato pizza, but not without passing by a Lululemon filled with people buying leggings for $100. There's an intentional recipe that goes into the fabrication of an inviting and accessible campus. These stores influence a cult-like culture on campus by creating an unspoken uniform for the student body. While many students still wear what they feel most comfortable in, they recognize the pressure to buy something to fit in. These businesses also accelerate economic tourism, which then accelerates the rate of gentrification and displaces residents. And when it comes to the Ivy Leagues, you never know who might be sitting next to you. Many students recalled their first moments encountering peers with well-known family names and wealth that opens doors they didn't even know existed. There is a universal acknowledgement that Ivy League students with legacy backgrounds might receive opportunities above others that were more qualified, undermining the notion that hard work will be rewarded. For Black students that need to provide for themselves, hard work as a simple solution is a farce. Students are encouraged to join a number of student organizations and acquire student leadership roles in order to increase their chances of success, but that road inevitably leads to burnout. You can't pull yourself up by your bootstraps if you don't have any boots to begin with.
Pilar Lee, University of Southern California, USC. Major, Journalism. Class, 2023.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.